Welcome back to this session, class. And I think the last session was a new product development. We are now going to look at segmentation. And as we said earlier on, in financial services, the development of new product is quite easy. It's very easy to make a new product because it's about identifying and adding to existing attributes sometimes. You know, doing a little changes here and there in order to appeal to, you know, segments of the financial services. Now, in that sense, it means that there are quite a number of subcategories when it comes to financial services. You know, you could have so many categories as a result of, you know, the risk factors, for example. So you have mortgage, and when you look at mortgage, for example, and the way the mortgage market works, the first-time buyers could actually be considered as in a high risk because obviously their first time, you know, you're just about to test, you know, the ability to afford a mortgage, etc. Yeah, then you can have maybe mature families, may not necessarily be first-time buyers, but they might have actually owned a property before. Their risk profile may be different. Now, within the same mortgage, you realize that you could have two or three different segments, you know, in there. So you realize that when it comes to segments, there are quite a number of sub-segments in financial services, quite a diverse, you know, area. Although even if one, and especially when it comes to, say, the commercial, you know, not consumer market, but the commercial, you know, market as well, you could see that you have small business owners, you have medium level businesses, you have, you know, also you have what do you call the big businesses, or you know, the multinationals and other things. So there are quite a lot of layers, you know, when it comes to financial services segments. So today we're going to look at the various segments in financial services, and it says that one of the unique characteristics of financial services market is the existence of so many subgroups of consumers with different financial needs. Now, this has resulted in the formation of distinct consumer segments with varying characteristics and financial aspirations. Often the financial needs of the various segments can be mapped against specific categories of financial services. As a result, financial services marketers have the ability to effectively target each of the segments with unique, customized marketing pitches, which are mostly likely create customers' responses within the segment. Usual session outline. Credit card segment, we'll look at the variables for segmenting financial services. Cluster analysis, we'll look at that. We talked about it, you know, sometime in the last session. Common approaches to targeting specific segments, you know, and then segmenting targeting through predictive models. Reading list, as usual. Okay, so this is credit card, you know, kind of segment, or the credit card as a product, as a financial product or financial services. And you can see cardholder, the type, basic cardholders, usually it's for transactional purposes only. You know, transaction processes, that's the benefit that you get. The loyalty cards, you know, again, rewards such as airline miles or discounts. So there are cards that actually give you those things. I mean, airline miles, or even, you know, for example, people who buy fuel at a particular filling station get Nectar points, you know, where you can redeem, you know, the points. Maybe there will be a group of businesses put together, let's say the retail shops, you know, fuel stations and other shops, they come together to form a loyalty card that you can actually use across these, you know, retail outlets. Premium cards, it allows you to access specific benefits secured by the card. So for example, you can own an airline premium card that allow you to use maybe priority lounges, allow you to use maybe some internet facilities at certain points, airports, you know, that allow you to maybe use other restaurants, you know, during the time of your travel, maybe at a particular airport, you know, at a transit. Some of them allow you to airport pickups, you know, and things like that. And then you have small business reward cards, transaction processing, detailed account information. So most of these small business cards allow, you know, the holder to have some of these rewards. And again, they can sometimes afford you, you know, accounting services, you know, where the bank could actually say that as a holder of this card, you're entitled to, let's say, some bookkeeping softwares or some accounting services or advisory, financial advice of a particular nature. And then super elite card. And when we talk about super elite card, we're talking about cards like, you know, diners or, well, cards like the black, you know, Amex, that American black card, which is actually an invitation only card. That is, you don't apply for it. You're actually invited for it. And we'll see how those cards actually work. So credit card segment, basic cards, like we said, they have no core benefits. It's just for transactional purposes only. It helps you to retrieve money from the ATM and then do other things, but without any additional benefits, you know. Loyalty-driven cards, mostly co-branded, like I said, Nectar cards, for example, actually allow other participating firms or companies to share in that particular. How do you compute the mile equivalent? Now, present immediately observable benefits like cash savings, etc. Premium cards, we've talked about American Express, Diners Club, you know, they operate on annual fee basis in return for privileges and member benefit, auto insurance, access to events, etc. Then of course we have small cards, small business cards. We've talked about expense reporting for taxes and planning. The majority of small business owners use them. Benefits such as discount on shipping, travel, etc. You know, it could be gained. Super Elite, the Amex Black Card. And like I said, this card is an invitation only. And it has perhaps an annual payment of about £2,500 or dollars or so. And then of course, you must actually pay an upfront fee of about 7,000, you know, thereabout. About 7,500 thereabout. So an upfront fee and a monthly fee. And it allows you so many things, you know, and that's the top elite. Now, so when we say segmentation, we're talking about breaking down the entire market into pieces that you can actually work. But those pieces must be measurable and they must be, you know, commercially, you know, sensible to do. So you want to say that, yes, this is the entire market, but how could you actually break it down into pieces that are actually commercial in terms of, you know, servicing them and in terms of returns that you get? So we say the breaking up the market of buyers into subgroups, you know, that people in each segment are very similar to one another. However, they are fairly different, you know, against them. So you think about it like a subset, and within the set, insets are similar characteristics, and against each set are far apart differences, you know, so that targeting them with different offers will make sense. So segmentation process, as we know, is about measure a sample of consumers on important characteristics. You know, use computer software to identify segment and consumer characteristics and develop a plan to target segments of interest. So you usually want to categorize this segment. Either you're using variables such as age, gender, or lifestyle of a particular style, you know, you use that to actually segregate or to break the market into different groups. And then you have a plan. How do you target that particular or each and every segment? Perhaps the younger segment, maybe 18 to 35 cohorts, could be reached via the internet, as we saw in the previous, you know, session on product development. You realize that the young cohorts are predominantly online, are predominantly using modern technologies. So the way and manner that you sell the financial product to them or you target them is quite different from the age, the older categories, because again, in that session, we realized that majority of the 41 plus are actually crucially interested in the location of the bank branch. You know, location is crucial for them because they're predominantly not online. So you would have to develop a plan about, in a plan on how do you target the segment and how do you make sure that you get the most out of it. So variable for segmentation in financial services, we say that the sources, you know, could be internally collected data. You know, the data that you have actually internally collected as a result of your engagement with the consumer. Obviously, once you come into contact with a consumer, you want to know their age, you want to know their gender, you want to know their addresses, and you want to know what actually satisfies them. I mean, these are basic information that usually you get, you know, from the interaction with consumer, you know, with a little bit of forms to fill and questioning, you know, you get this information. Internal data warehouses and customer service could also, you know, customer service could also give you those information. Externally, we buy data, you know, from sources. Companies usually buy data from credit card, you know, scores like Expedia, Equifax, for example, the credit, you know, kind of companies. You can also buy from other, you know, online-based firms like, you know, Expedia, for example, or TripAdvisor, for example, can get you databases, you know, of customers that could be meaningful, you know, to you. And then we have segmentation specialists like Claritas, etc. They sell data. But of course, we must be mindful of data buying because the issue about ethical and, you know, ethics and issue about data protection, sometimes you may be buying data and then we may be actually dragging ourselves into some of these legal minefields. I mean, recently there had been cases in the UK where companies have boasted that they have customer data that they can actually sell to businesses. And you're talking about customer data of even young people. You know, sometimes as little as babies, the data and people actually boasting that they can actually sell it to companies, and it had become a big, big issue. So we have to be mindful of what data are we buying, what is the legal constraint, or what is the legal position in that. Now, internally collected segment predictors. Now, we're saying that when you're actually, you know, doing segmentation, like we said, internally, internal data can be useful. And in most cases, you have this basic demographics: age, gender, income level, wealth, social class, household size and composition, home addresses. Life stage, again, you know, at what stage is the person? As a young person, school going to college, you know, just out of school, working. All these stages we can actually get from internal data. Psychographic, lifestyles, attitude towards the category, your brand, and generally, knowledge of the category and of your brand. Brand-specific predictors, loyalty towards your brand, underlying motivation behind the purchase of brand and category. These are all information that we collect, we tend to collect, you know, at a point of contact with customers, either during the consumption or, you know, before or during, after. So we collect those data internally. And external purchase segment predictors. We have said that, you know, geodemographic segmentation, for example, city blocks mapped against lifestyle, income, purchases, characteristics. Each household is assigned a probability for purchasing various types of financial product. And we have Claritas, Acorn, you know, Cassie, and Mosaic. Now, in this country, for example, I mean, the AMA has what they call the demarcation, you know, what data, which they have demarcated the entire Accra, for example, into different segments, into different, you know, economic, you know, levels, to high income, middle income, and low income, and the type of households, you know, they have, or the household settings. So some of these data are available. Of course, we have SMS companies, you know, around that actually do bulk SMS, you know, services. Most of these firms actually have data that they sell to companies that are in need. So credit-based use of credit bureau data, example, credit scores at individual consumer levels are available. Cluster analysis, as we saw in the earlier, you know, session, is about you forming clusters of consumers, as in consumer groups, you know, of like-minded or like characteristics, but also separate from others. So you have such that consumers in the same cluster are very similar to one another, but very different from consumers in other clusters. And in the process of cluster analysis, you sample of consumers. You have the sample of consumers, age, income, wealth, credit score, and then you put them to various cluster analysis. I mean, you do the cluster analysis, and then you put them to various segments. So those of age group, you know, so income level and lifestyle, for example. And then you can actually group them, but they will be predominantly different from the other clusters. So this is a typical example of a cluster analysis needed. So your respondent's name, So you have J Powers, D-State Camp, etc. Their age, their credit scores, average credit card balance, household income, others. Now, you can plot them on this graph, on this, plot them in the sense that you have the credit score there, and then you have the age here. So if you have J Powers, age 29, credit score 65 is 650, average credit card balance is 845, household income 78,000. So you can see that the age, because the higher, you know, it comes here, the higher the age. So you can see 29 perhaps somewhere here, and then the credit score somewhere there. So as you plot it, yeah, I mean, this is roughly sketched, but you can plot them. And once you actually, you know, do the plotting, you can then group this into two segments. You know, segment one, segment two, all those inching towards high age band, you know, and that could actually form one cluster. The other one could actually form another cluster. Same thing, you can actually do it this way. So cluster analysis output. So three cluster example. So cluster one, cluster two, cluster three. Which, and the variables you have average age, average credit score, average income, and then the rest of it. So you see cluster one, age 28, average credit score 590, average income 105,200, you know, 105,200, etc. Then you have your three clusters. So you would see that each of those names up there may represent in one of those clusters. You know, so J Powers, N Davidson, L Kemp belong to one cluster, and D Hansen, Johnson, Mayer belong to another cluster, and then another cluster. So cluster analysis consideration, you ensure that the segments are large enough and meaningful. Ensure variables used are not correlated. So we realize that the variables are not correlated over there, either because you have age and you have credit scores and other things. And then ensure iterative processes. So you could actually do it, you know, over period. And then sample sizes, 100 or higher, typically required. Number of variables used less than 10 to avoid correlation among predictors from contaminating the estimates. So common approaches to targeting specific segments in financial services. We can also use technology, that is monitoring ATM use, internet use, phone use, etc. So you can monitor that how many people predominantly use ATM and what type of people are there. So again, like we saw in the previous in the presentation, the observational method. You can actually put observational cameras, you know, surveillance cameras or CCTVs, and then monitor the character of the people who consistently use ATM at a particular spot. Now, what's the age category? Maybe you can see that fairly young people highly, you know, access the ATM systems. That can help you in your segmentation. You know, the internet use, you can track and find out what type of accounts are being accessed online, what's their age profile, and then the phone, you can actually use that. I mean, what are the phone coming in, what is the direct code of people calling it? Are they calling from a particular area, or are they calling from a particular, you know, age group? We can also look at retail presence, you know, how many people actually come through the retail door, you know, and then the distribution of other distribution outlets. Personal touch and service accessibility, you know, again, similar things. Price point, low prices versus high quality, you know, which options are people taking, which category or which profile of customers actually go for those ones. Product breadth, so what's the range of product that people are buying in single segment concentration? Again, what type of insurance or what type of product services are being bought by a particular, you know, segment. So segmenting, targeting through predictive models. The use of predictive models, for example, when you're actually using predictive models, for example, you're looking at what would someone buy to actually predict in another purchase. So for example, if somebody actually buys, let's say somebody actually buys what do you call wedding scheme, or maybe marriage, what do you call, or maybe opening a marriage account or whatever account. Now, predictably, you can actually assume that the person is likely to come for maybe child education policy or something like that, you know. So there are many ways that we can actually predict, you know, people's purchasing behavior using predicting, you know, modeling. So you have the calibration sample with data on existing customers' predictor and actual behavior. So the existing customer buys something over time. Over time, we can build profile on the person and assume the next level of purchase or the next kind of purchase the person will buy. If someone buys, let's say, or someone actually signs on a mortgage, you know, kind of, you know, scheme or mortgage account, we're most likely to predict that perhaps content, you know, insurance can follow. You know, you can predict other things. So you have the predictive model into estimated model parameters. You establish those parameters, and then that leads to new prospect data, and then prediction of the prospect future behavior. So you can actually, you know, predict all these. Calibration data. So the data that is with the business, you know, is not so much refined, and you could actually, you know, use it, but you can actually use it as a basis to predict. You know, so you have customer name, age, credit score, average credit balance, household income, timely payment of bills. So based on this, you can use it to predict the person's behavior, you know, over time. You know, timely payment of bills, no. Timely payment of bills, yes. Yes, no. So based on these ones, you can actually predict somebody's, you know, behavior for a particular, you know, purchase. Predicted behavior marketing action for prospect. So you have prospect name, age, credit score, predictive function value, prediction of timely payment of bills, marketing action. So what action do you have to take? Some of them ignore. Some of them direct market or direct mail will do, telemarketing or email promotion would actually lead them to, you know, take a particular action. Now, under the segmentation also, we have a customer relationship management as a key part, because segments have to be serviced, and they have to service with the creation of a what relationship, because there are certain segments that are highly, you know, that are difficult to serve. And as a result, if your relationship, you know, activities, your relationship marketing activities is not coherent or is not comprehensive, then of course you're gonna actually lose out of them. So you've got to actually take customer relationship seriously in financial services. And we're saying that total profit of financial services, for example, is profit from a single customer multiplied by the number of customers that you have. Obviously that gives you a total profit. But you could only, you know, achieve that, you know, if you have a very good CRM systems that also gives you the profile of the customers and how each and every customer must be dealt with. You know, it has to be, you know, defined. So you define marketing customer relationship as marketing activities, processes, procedures aimed at initiating, increasing, and strengthening the relationship between the company and its existing clients. So the process involves that. So transition focus. So you get the prospect, or you get a suspect into prospect, and you move them from prospect into customer, from customer to client, and client to a supporter. That is when you have achieved a high level of relationship with this person. So you see the focus segmentation, that is when you actually suspect prospect, you segment them. Here you target them with offering to make sure that they get satisfied. And once they're satisfied, you ensure that they are delighted. And that is when you have achieved a full bond, you know, with the customers. Various methods for measuring customer loyalty. Obviously, we look at the number of repeated purchase or transactions that a customer has with you actually defines or explains, you know, the level of loyalty that you have with a person. Lot complaint data. Usually when customers are not happy and cannot find, kind of have a relationship with you, they won't complain. Once they have a bad service, immediately they leave. Now you want to look at your lot complaint to see how many people keeps coming back and actually saying that this product has to be looked at, this service has to be looked at. then of course you know that you are actually establishing some bond with them. But of course, if you don't take any action, they won't stay. So once they complain, you take action, you move on forward, you move on, and then you're sure that you're actually establishing some relationship with them. Customer service, again, service can actually help us to determine people's satisfaction level and whether they're ready to continue the relationship with us. Retention and defection behavior in financial services. Exit barriers can help customer retention. You know, so when you have a high exit barrier, of course, that could actually keep people indoors. But again, is it the coercion or is just that, you know, the alternatives are not there? Again, that could be a problem. But yes, they will help retention. So encouraging customers to stay, employee protocols to deal with exit, contractual and perceptual ties to keep customers, and bundling other services. So when you have other services put together, perhaps it could serve as a one-stop shop for customers, and therefore they could actually stay. Customers who pay bills online are almost half as likely to leave the bank than other customers. Well, perhaps the ease of transfer, you know, when they pay bills online and things like that, you don't go to the counter where you foresee that you'll be frustrated and you have to go and queue for so long. It is fairly easy to sit in your room, create a new account, and then there you go, you move. So it is more likely for people to leave when they are online bankers than when they are, you know, in store or in branch, you know, bankers. Customers who have their credit card issued by a retailer tend to shop there nearly twice as often than other consumers. Yeah, when the card is being issued by a retailer, it makes sense, you know, that you actually use it. But it's also the understanding that people think that, of course, because the card has been issued by the retailer, is much more accepted, or you're likely to be successful in shopping with it than elsewhere. And of course, the retailer may give you certain incentives as a result of the use of the card. So it makes sense that a lot of people would use it in that particular retailer that issued a card. Most customers closing a bank account are not asked why. Well, banks don't ask why they, you know, shutting it down, but it's important that you do. Methods for increasing customer loyalty. So bundling. Are you able to bundle different offers into one so that the person has it a one-stop shop? If you do that, you're likely to increase people's, you know, retention or increase retention. So bundling of auto insurance, homeowners insurance, umbrella policy, term life insurance, second auto insurance. So the person feels there's value because it's not now, the people don't have time. So if they have the insurance with one person that can actually do all the things, then of course they are happy to stay. Provide meaningful incentives, example, loyalty programs that match customers' needs. Contact customers close to renewal time. And I have been a victim of this actually. You know, when I found that the insurance company was not actually contacting to renew, I had to move on, you know, because I thought that they don't want my business. But if you can contact, I mean, some companies do quite a lot more. They make sure that at every stage in time, they tell you when the policy is going to expire. You know, 3 months, your policy would expire, take action. Or 1 week, policies expire. 1 month, policies expire. They wouldn't wait for a week, no. They'll keep reminding you when the policy is expiring. Methods for increasing customer loyalty continued. Solicit complaints. Empower employees to resolve complaints. Facilitate as much personal contact with a customer, you know. Accessibility and preferential treatment of valuable customers is encouraged. All right, thank you so much. The end of this session on segmentation. And obviously we've seen how in financial services we can have various, you know, sub groups of segmentation and how we can actually target them with our service offering. We've seen that it is easier for customers, for example, segment that actually bank online to leave, you know, than those who actually go in branch, and many others. Thank you.